declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming his flesh. And these are the days servant David rebuilding your temple of praise. Oh, these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds,
there's no God like Jehovah. Good morning, good morning. Friday morning already. Wow, do you know not? Okay, let me adjust that a little bit. There you go. Wow, fast a week goes. Good morning, Miss Ruth. You popped up there first time this morning, so it's good to see you up there. And Miss Terry, we love you three times over as well. Miss Carolyn, good morning to you. It is great to see you. And Miss Helen, it is good to have you on as well. And as others come in and decide to sign in, we're going to say good morning to all of you. It's been a great week, a wonderful week, a week that God has blessed greatly. I'm looking forward to the weekend, and it is Labor Day weekend, so we'll have people on the road and traveling, so you want to be prepared to pray for them as well. Kirk and Tanya made it to his dad's down in Yuma just fine. They got there safely, which we are very glad of. It was 117 degrees, I think, Sherry told me down there yesterday. A little warm. They couldn't get the house quite as cool as they needed it to be. But it is warm, warm, warm. And there is Miss Sue this morning. Good morning, Miss Sue. Bunny needed a change. Thank you. Yes, okay. Bunny needed a rest. Didn't need to be on the picture this morning. Okay. God bless you guys. You just delight my heart more than you'll ever, ever be able to realize. All of you. Cynthia, good morning to you and Ryan. It's good to see you out there this morning. Pray you are having a lovely day. It is beautiful out here, is it not? Okay, well, chapter 4 of Galatians ends with Paul unfolding for us that allegory that consists, that contrasts slavery of the slavery of those who are under the bondage of law with the freedom of those who are under faith by grace. I want to read that section to you, give you great clarity. Good morning, my dear. I love you. I saw you earlier as you took the puppies upstairs. So in the Amplified, it kind of expands out what we talked about yesterday. It says, tell me, you who are bent on being under the law, do you not listen to what the law really says? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman, Hagar, and one by a free woman, Sarah. But the child of the slave woman was born according to the flesh and had an ordinary birth, while the son of the free woman was born in the fulfillment of the promise. Verse 24. Now, these facts are about to be used by me as an allegory. That is, I will illustrate by using them. For these women can represent two covenants. One, a covenant that originated from Mount Sinai, where the law was given, that bears children destined for slavery under the law, and she is Hagar. Now, Hagar is or represents Mount Sinai in Arabia, and she corresponds with present-day Jerusalem, for she is in slavery with her children. You see, all of those that are still following the Levitical laws are still under the slavery and bondage to the law. And every child born are born into that slavery. Verse 26, but the Jerusalem above, that is the way of faith represented by Sarah, is free. And she is our mother. Now, all that Abraham and Hagar produced on their own was a son who would not be an heir. All that Israel produced when they tried to keep the law on their own was legalism, which would inherit nothing but bondage. Our life, our freedom, flow down from him. And our lives are already securely written, our names, in the citizens' registry of that city, in the Lamb's Book of Life, if you will. Now, Sarah represents that city because she gave birth to Isaac, not by reliance on herself, because she had a dead body as far as being able to produce a child, without any reliance on herself, but by an act of God from above in the fulfillment of his promise to them. Therefore, spiritually speaking, she is the mother of all who believe. If Abraham is the father of all who believe, she is the mother of all believe. The people whose lives are not merely the product of human resources, but of God's supernatural work in their life. Or as John would say, those born not of the will of the flesh or the will of man, but born of the will of God. Now, our real life is not like Ishmael's, simply owing to the work of man. Our real life, our eternal life, is owing to the work of God in us, fulfilling his promises to make himself a people and to put his spirit within them and write his law on their hearts, as the prophets Ezekiel and Jeremiah tell us. Now, for those who are free, his passion becomes their passion. His desires, their desires, his will, their will, his wants, their wants, his dislikes, their dislikes. Therefore, those who are free, and I mean free indeed, have the freedom of desire. They don't slavishly labor under a burden of having to do what they don't want to do. They're free to do what they love to do, and to do whatever they want, love to do, forever in perfect joy. There's no coercion. Nobody has to twist their arm to go to church or you know, wrestle them down and tie them to a chair, you know, to have Bible study. They don't have to press them into a prayer life. They don't have to do anything. They don't have to, you know, do any of that, because they go to fellowship because they want to. They love to. They worship because they have a heart to do that now. They're in the Word daily because that's the hunger of their heart, and they need that satisfaction for their soul. They don't labor and work for the kingdom out of compulsion, coercion, but because they're compelled to by love. So when you get down to the end of it, he opens up then. He marries two things together, and exclamation point on what he says starts in the fifth verse, when it says, or the fifth chapter, where it says, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." That's verse 1 of that fifth chapter. For freedom, Christ has set us free. It was for freedom that Christ set us free. Therefore, keep standing firm and do not subject yourself again to the yoke of slavery. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you that we can come to the end of this week and still just find this hunger that we have to more know you more clearly and plainly and understand your desire for our life. God, I pray that if there are any that have been listening to these studies that have taken themselves back under the law and trying to please you and gain your favor without trusting you, that God, you will bring them to their senses today. And hear even Paul's words ringing, "Who have bewitched you, O foolish, foolish people, thinking that you were saved by faith, that you are now made perfect by the works of the law? May it never be." But Father, let us embrace you. Embrace your Messiah, our Savior, our Lord. Embrace your Holy Spirit, that we may know freedom that is truly freedom indeed. Thank you for bringing us into your kingdom and placing us in your family and writing our names in the Lamb's Book of Life. But God, there's more beyond that. Thank you for the sanctifying process that is now at work in each of our lives. And let us yield up to it in faith, trusting you. God, we may do the same things that we used to do under the compulsion of the law, but now as we're trusting you, Lord, it's all for your glory, and it flows from you as we walk in the fullness of your Spirit. Bless us now as we come back into your word, Lord. Encourage us, give us wisdom, understanding, and open the eyes of our hearts that we might see the very glory of our God. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Well, this is where Paul opens this fifth chapter. You know, we have freedom. You know, Christ is, you know, for freedom's sake, Christ has set us free. That's what this first verse is all about. The text begins with a clear and refreshing statement of Christ's will for our lives. He wills that we would be free, and free indeed. Free to serve him, free to choose, free to throw off the very shackles of sin and the old man that has held us in captivity all our life. Sometimes we get bogged down in a quandary about God's will. And we often worry about decisions which are simply simple and not of great issue with God. You know, where to go to school, what job to take, where to live, you know, those sorts of things. And I talk to people all the time, so I just need to know what God's will is for my life. And we talk about orienting our lives on the clear statements of Scripture regarding the will of God. And here is one. It was for freedom that Christ has set you free. Therefore, keep standing firm and do not be subject again to the yoke of slavery. You know, when people come in and they're struggling with what the will of God is for their life, I often will sit down with them and say, okay, what do you know to be God's will? So I'd ask you all the same question this morning. What do you know to be God's will? I mean, just stuff that is plainly set out there for us. Let me throw one out for you. In all things give thanks, for this works the perfect will of God. So in everything that comes your way, are you offering and lifting up thanksgiving to God, praising Him and honoring Him for whatever opportunity, good or bad? Because if we have thankful hearts and thankful lips in all things, we're working out the perfect will of God. Is that not right? Is there any way that you are living in bondage or in slavery in some way? Is there some passion or pride or some besetting, an old word that we don't use much anymore, a besetting sin, a habitual sin that recurs and recurs? Then this says that for freedom, Christ has set you free from those. You're free from the bondage of sin. You're free from those things that hold you captive. You're free from those besetting sins. Instead, now you are free to love Him, to worship Him, to serve Him with a gladness of heart. You see, this is the will of God, that you not be subject again to the yoke of slavery. So I ask over and over and over, what do you know to be the will of God? What does Scripture tell us plainly, clearly, making statements of God's will, what the will of God is? The will of God is that none should perish. Now, that will is different. It is the desire of God that none perish, but all come to repentance. All right? That's God's desire. Doesn't mean that everybody will, but you see, if we want to desire what God desires, do we desire for everybody around us that we know to be saved? Well, if we do, then we need to understand that the will of God is that we do the work of the evangelist, right? Isn't that what he says? Isn't that what Paul clearly says when he says, do the work of the evangelist? I think he's talking to Timothy at that time. Think about it now. Then at the end of that, when we go through this and they kind of make a checkoff list and say, well, I'm doing that, but I'm not doing this, not doing this, not doing this, not doing this. My question is always this. If you are not hungry to do the will of God that you know to be His will, why should God give you revelation on this sort of thing, where He wants and what He wants? You see, I don't think we can pick and choose our points of obedience. It's not a smorgasbord, if you will. It's not a cafeteria. We can go down and say, you know, I love fried chicken, so I'm going to load up on fried chicken, and I love corn on the cob, so I'm going to load up that, but I don't like liver, so I'm going to push that away, or I don't like cabbage, I'm going to push that away. You understand what I mean? We take the whole menu, folks, when we come to Him. And we are free to live like that. Miss Laura, And I don't know whether Chris is there with you, but I love you. Love you, love you. It's good to see you on there this morning. You see, Christ's will for you and for me is that we enjoy the freedom that He's given us. Where you go to school, what job you do, where you live, all of those things are not nearly as crucial as whether you're standing fast in the freedom that God's giving you. If you're living in the known and perceived will of God. If they were, the Bible would have commanded those things as clearly as it commands our freedom here. Chris and Sonoma. Hey, Sonoma. God bless you. Good to see you, little girl. I can't physically see you, but I can mentally see you. If these were as important as some other things, He would have a chapter in there telling you where to go to school and what job to take. In some ways He does, because whatever job you take needs to honor God. There's some jobs, for example, a drug dealer has a job, but it doesn't honor God. I think you get the point. Where you live probably isn't nearly as important as what you do where you live. How you live where you live. All right? So your enjoyment of freedom is much more important to God than many of the day-to-day decisions that fill us with so much concern. Maybe we ought to be more concerned with living freely in the commands that God has given us than we are. And you know what? One of the nearly day by day concerned discussions that Sherry and I have after 51 years, almost every day we go through this discussion as if it's so much hangs on it. Here it is. I'll be working away, studying, typing, putting together lessons and messages, and Sherry will be doing insurance work at the other. And one of us is going to say, well, what do we want to have for dinner tonight? I don't know. What do you want to have for dinner tonight? I don't know. What do you want to have? Well, I chose last night. No, I think I made the decision last night. Well, we get quiet and we work a little bit more. Well, let's think about it. And then, a little while later, well, we haven't made any decisions about dinner. What are we going to eat tonight? How many of you have had those kind of discussions in your home over and over and over? Is it all that important? Probably not. Maybe some of our conversations ought to be a little bit more like, who do we need to witness to today? Or, I think you get the idea. Your enjoyment of freedom is a lot more important to God than where you're going to have or what you're going to have for dinner tonight and all those other little concerns that we have. Now, don't get me wrong. God is concerned about all the little things in our life. You see, God cares. He is concerned about those things that concern you. Now, a good test of our priorities would be whether we are just as concerned about the command to enjoy our freedom as we are about other passing decisions in life. Do we exercise as much diligence in prayer and study to be steadfast in our freedom as we do in deciding our home, our job, our school, our married partner, or where we're going to eat tonight? You see, it's a clear and unqualified command. Stand firm and do not be subject again to the yoke of slavery. Now there's a black and white in your face command. Now if we're very concerned about that command, more so than where we work or where we live, then when those opportunities to sin or those opportunities to rebel, those opportunities to go back under slavery, we look at it with wide eyes and say, I'm standing firm. I'm not going that direction. This is the will of God for you. Your freedom, uncompromising, unrelenting, indomitable, unconquerable freedom. This is God's will for your life. For this Christ died. For this He arose. For this He sent His Spirit. There is nothing He wills with more intensity under the glory of His own name than this, your freedom and my freedom. He spells this out so clearly and beautifully to the Pharisees when He's talking about them being slaves. He says, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. And you'll know the truth. And the truth will set you free. He said, when have we ever been a slave? Well, they didn't recognize they were slaves to sin. They were slaves to the law. And at that particular time, they were slaves to the nation of Rome. But they had deluded themselves. That's my message for today. All else is explanation and incentive. We are facing freedom or we face bondage. The other day, we took a look at this is a couple of weeks ago, the gargantuan task of cleaning out the garage yet once again. There were some things that we needed to do, and I was just going to go out and clear a pathway, if you understand what I'm saying. We have a two-car garage that has never had a car in it. But it's a great storage unit. You understand what I'm saying? And it gets and we have this little habit trail that goes through it sometimes, and it frustrates me. But it's a gargantuan task. It is really a huge task. Now, mind you, I hadn't planned on doing that, but I wanted to get my fishing gear out of the closet, because I was going to take it up in case there was an opportunity, or in case, you know, it was a good time to go fishing when we went up to Spokane. And it's stored in a closet. I do have that much organization. But there were about 15 layers of other stuff in front of the closet that I couldn't get to. Well, one thing led to the other. I'm a little bit frustrated at how I'd let things get out of hand again, out of control again, piled up again. I wasn't having a lot of fun. It was a task. It was labor. It was work. After about 45 minutes, Josh came out to see what I was doing, and without even me asking, he chipped in and, you know, started dragging stuff out and throwing stuff out and piling stuff up. From then on in, it turned from drudgery and work to fun and productivity. He was out there, and we would give it some, we would joke, and we would, you know, we would give each other a hard time, and I'd throw something at him, he'd kick something back at me. But listen, in both cases, the work would get done, would it not? It would get done, but in one, it would take a little longer, and it would leave me really frustrated by the end of the day, and just a little ill-tempered, if you can believe that. I know it's hard for any of you to believe that occasionally I get just a little bit on the edge of being ill-tempered. I never really get over that edge, you understand. But in the other way, the work got done quicker, more efficiently, more thoroughly. And throughout it, it was coupled with joy and fellowship, unity, laughter, and a fullness of heart. The outcome in both those scenarios was the same. The garage in each would have got and did get clean, but put in order. So what's the difference? If it's going to get done and it's going to be put in order, what's the difference? The difference is this: I wasn't alone in the task. That made all the difference in the world. I had Josh there alongside me, helping, making it an enjoyable experience. The same work to do? Yeah. But in one case, it was under the yoke of slavery, as it was. In the other case, it was under the freedom that is freedom indeed. There is a clue here of how we live in freedom and obey Galatians 1:5. You got your pencils ready? Write this down. The key to freedom is whether you have to do the work yourselves to escape punishment or whatever, or whether our Father comes down to be with us and to help us. And it really was done better, with a much better outcome. Thank you for putting in that word, my dear. I will repeat that. She said it really was done better, and much better outcome, with a thumbs up. Yeah, I was a much happier cat at the end of the day than I would have been the other way around. But you see, the key to freedom is whether you do the work by yourself, in your own strength, in your power, or whether the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, they just come down to help you with the work. Now, I think that will be evident as we move into verses 2 through 5. Verses 2, 3, and 4 each portray a way to stay under the yoke of slavery So these verses function as warnings against slavery. Then verse 5 gives us a positive description of how to stand in freedom. So let's look at these verses in turn, if you will. Don't bribe God for a blessing is what I would title verses 2 and 3. And here it says, behold, I, Paul, say to you that if you receive circumcision, Christ will not be of benefit to you, or Christ will profit you nothing. And I testify again to every man who receives circumcision that he is under obligation to keep the whole law. Or literally, he is a debtor to the whole law. He's in a bondage to that debt. The point in verses 2 and 3 is not that circumcision itself was wrong, but it was that the act was wrong when we do it to bribe God for a blessing. The Judaizers are saying before God can bless you, you have to become like us. So you need to be circumcised. So they go under the knife for the purpose of trying to please God and get a blessing. They're bribing him. Okay, God, I'll do this. It's like me sitting heading to the office in high school after getting busted for smoking in the bathroom saying, God, if you'll get me out of this, I will. God, if you'll give me, I promise you I'll go to Sunday school. I promise you I'll do this. I promise you I'll do that if you'll just get me out of this. That's that foxhole conversion. Now, some of those are legitimate, yes. But most of them is just trying to bribe God. Circumcision happened to be the foremost requirement that the Judaizers were placing upon the congregations there in Galatia and teaching the Galatians to work their way to God's favor. So in verses 3 through 5, he reminds us how circumcision relates to freedom and slavery. He says in verse 3, but not even Titus, who was with me, though he was Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. But it was because of the false brethren, probably those same Judaizers, secretly brought in, who had sneaked in to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, in order to bring us into bondage. But we did not yield in subjection to them for even 1 hour, so that the truth of the gospel may remain for you. That's what Paul means in verse 1. Stand firm. Do not be subject again to the yoke of slavery. And he uses this incident to say, listen, when we came in, not even Titus was compelled to be circumcised, even though these who had slipped in, these Judaizers who were spying out our liberty, which we have in Christ, they were there to force these points on it, to bring us back under the kind of bondage that God had delivered us out of. But we wouldn't have it. Do not let the Judaizers, he says, bewitch you into thinking that circumcision or any other outward act of obedience can be offered to God as a benefit to him. God, see, I'm that Pharisee saying, it's a good thing you have me on your side, God. And I'm not like this guy back here. See, I'm here, I'm a benefit to you, God. Benefit which he must then reward with some payment. So look closely at verse 2. If you receive circumcision, Christ will be of no benefit to you. The problem with the Judaizers was that they wanted to cash in on Christ's profit, but only by making investments with him from their own moral assets. And Paul says, if you try to earn dividends from God from your own investments in circumcision or dietary rules or feast days, you're not going to get a profit out of it. Christ, this life, you know, all of this will profit you nothing. Why? Because all spiritual and physical benefits Christ gives are dividends paid from his own investment at Calvary, and not our meager investments in our flesh-activated works. When the Son of God died for our sins, the moral assets which he invested in the bank of God's glory were so great that the dividends are infinite and endless and available to all who, what? Who wants it. Verse 2 says, Christ's profits are not yours if you try to earn them with your own investments. Why? Because it dishonors Christ. It nullifies grace, as Paul says back in chapter 2, verse 21. And it removes the stumbling block of the cross. It says that none of that was necessary. It says if I can get these dividends from my own work, from my own investments of my own flesh, then Christ didn't have to be beaten. He didn't have to be crucified. He didn't have to die. He didn't have to shed his blood. He didn't have to be buried. And he didn't have to raise again. It nullifies everything. Because you see, we exalt in the cross and grace and Christ when we admit we have no assets to invest. We're bankrupt. Spiritually, morally, we're bankrupt. And that Christ's investments at Calvary were totally sufficient to win dividends of righteousness and life for all who trust him for all of eternity. You see, it's like having this huge bank account paying out dividends and I didn't put one dime into the account. I just become the unbelievable beneficiary of the blessings that roll down. I can't say to God, well, some of that money in the bank, some of those assets are mine. Can I? And verse 2 teaches us that slavery is what it is when you reject Christ as a merciful benefactor who gives us freely a share of his endless profits. Slavery is when you choose to deal with him as a banker who needs your investment to produce dividends for his customers. Do you see God as an eternal banker? Oh, listen, I understand what he says. When he says, lay up your treasures in heaven where and not on earth where moth and rust corrupts and everything else. Certainly, I understand what that means. But you see, it means something much different than buying in my own salvation and my own sanctification. It means that God is piling up reward after reward after reward when we invest our life in the kingdom. And on that day that we stand before him, all that is there, all this that we have saved, that we've sent forward, is what's ever going to be left after everything goes to the fire. And all of that is going to be put at his feet, because he alone is worthy. Now, verse 3 says the same thing, but just a little bit differently. He says that I testify again to every man who receives circumcision that he is under the obligation to keep the whole law. Now, this verse teaches that the mindset of slavery is the mindset of a debtor, one who is under pressure to pay back what he's borrowed or needs to borrow. All the works of the law, including circumcision and dietary laws, feast days, all of these things are the currency with which the Judaizers aim to satisfy their debt to God. The surprising point of the verse for us is that God doesn't want to deal with us as debtors in this way. the next session, we're going to flesh out on, you know, next week, but I want to listen to, I want you to listen to this. As you serve God, are you serving him as a debtor? Saying, okay, I've borrowed grace, I've borrowed salvation, I've got all of this from God, and I've got to pay this great debt back. You see, if you borrow from a bank, then the burden of that debt lays on you, does it not? If you swipe that credit card, the burden of that debt is yours to pay. You bought something, you brought it home, but you've got to pay it back. It doesn't come free. And as long as you're paying out, you're under the burden of that debt. And you're not free from it. Because it just weighs on you. It presses on you. Well, when you came to Christ by faith, you received such an abundance from him that it has a tendency to make us feel like a debtor that has to pay God back. But we can't. You see, there is no way that God deals with us and makes us satisfy that debt. Why? Because Christ took all our debt upon him. He paid that debt. It's like you've swiped this credit card and you see how much you owe. And God just comes in and he wiped it all out. He said, no, I'll take care of that. Don't ever worry about it. It's gone, forgotten, wiped clean. Just enjoy your freedom. The freedom that I so abundantly have given you. Do you see God as your creditor? Or do you see him as the one who set you free, who paid the debt? Do you serve him and work for him so that you get something back from him? Or do you serve and work out of the freedom of a heart that knows that you're not doing this alone? God has come to get alongside you to clean out your garage. How do you see God? He freed you. So enjoy your freedom. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the endless love that we receive without merit. We thank you for the endless forgiveness that we certainly did not deserve. The endless mercy without which we could not sustain. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that we become the incredible beneficiaries of the immense investment that you have placed. And not one dime of our own resources went into that great legacy. And we now just simply receive the dividends and the benefits of all that Christ has done. So Lord, our labor isn't a labor of debt, it's a labor of love. Isn't a labor of obligation, it's a labor of desire. And we see you as our great benefactor, our holy, omnipotent King, the one to whom all blessings flow from. Lord, let us keep our freedom in mind as we go through this day and through this weekend. God, may you be magnified in our life and our dealings this week. In Jesus' name, amen. He has set you free, so be free indeed. And when it goes to serving, oh man, done from a heart compelled through love. What a difference when it is from this love relationship we have with Him and not from compulsion that we serve, that we give, that we live. Alyssa, Kara, Cam, Cody, God bless you, and you're welcome. Good to have you here today. May God bless. Listen, see you Sunday morning, 11 o'clock, 9:45 for Bible study. Come on down. 11 o'clock for worship. We're in 2 Peter. We're going to be looking at verses 5 through 7 and 8 Sunday. So come. Let's get together. Let's fill the place up. Let's rejoice. It's a Labor Day weekend. You got Monday off. You may have other plans. But if you're here, you're not on the road, come and let's just raise the roof and worship because we love Him. God bless you. Listen, I'll see you Sunday morning at 11. I'll also see you back here on Monday morning at 9 o'clock. God bless. I love you all, and we'll see you later.